is the Holy Spirit flame. We have a burning desire to lift up Jesus' name.
Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
We pray that that you come with a hungry hearts and expectation this morning. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. We don't plan on being before you long, and we do. Our expectation is that the Lord is going to speak a word in season to the hearts of the people. Each one of you will receive a word from the Lord that's custom tailored to your situation. Amen. Right. You know, I'm kind of a nuts and bolts type of preacher, minister. You know, I don't do a whole lot of, you know, the Greek says this, and, you know, the Apocrypha is this, you know, and I don't do a whole lot of that. I'm kind of more the where the rubber meets the road. I could talk about Daniel, but, you know, I don't know the last time I've been in the lion's den. So I don't know that I'm going to be able to relate real well with how to maneuver through the lion's den. And, you know, you understand what I'm saying. But what's really, really important to me is that when you need to pay your light bill, that's important. When you need to get a situation resolved with your spouse, you know, because, you know, husbands and wives go through things, amen, and they need a godly answer, amen. You know, there are lots of answers out there, but ain't all of them ain't godly, amen. So we need some godly answers to the situations that we may be facing, amen. And so, you know, that's kind of along the vein that the Lord steers me in. You know, not to downplay any direction that any other minister may preach or teach along, you know, because we are all fitly joined together in the body of Christ. Amen. And everybody's got their fingerprint. See, this is my fingerprint. Everybody's got an index finger with a fingerprint, unless you lost your finger or something. And then you won't have a fingerprint because you ain't got a finger. But for those of you who have a finger, you got a fingerprint. And it's specific just to you. That's how you are identified. That's how they catch you if you did something. Your prints was all over that bubble gum that you stole. Yeah, we got your DNA now. You don't say you ain't do it because, you know, you was chomping on that gum. Like, where you get that gum? My friend gave me it. Well, we saw where you stole it on the camera here, and your fingerprints is on there. Well, you know what? You was caught. Amen? But guess what? Guess what? God is so specific that he gives you something that's tailor-made just to you. Amen? And I believe this message is going to minister to your hearts in a tailor-made fashion. Amen? And I want y'all to be in agreement with me to receive exactly what you need from the Lord that's going to be customized just for you. Amen? But we're going to be talking about God's stimulus package. That's the title of the message. God's stimulus package. Now, I want to go ahead and remind you up front, you do want to take good notes because you will be tested on this material. Amen. No, we're not going to hand out pencil and paper at the end of the message, but the devil, he's waiting on the other side of them doors, and he's going to be administering some tests, and he ain't going to tell you when the test's going to be. It's always pop quiz. It's like, boop, clear your desk. Get your pencils out, clear your desk, put your notes away. Now it's test time. Hallelujah. But you're gonna have to put in practice what's gonna be in this word today. Amen. It does not fail. Every time I hear the word, something happens along those lines that I'm gonna have to deal with along those lines. And because God is so good, he's already said, this is how you resolve this issue. This is how you handle this when it comes up. That's isn't God good? He could wait till after you flunk the test and say, well, you know, here's what you should have done. You know, wait till after the fact and say, well, you know, you flunked miserably, and this is why you flunked miserably. But he's so good and awesome. He'll tell you, come before you even come in the classroom. You're about to have a test. Here are your answers. Here's the answer to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And you put them down just like this. And you're going to pass with flying colors. Oh, well, thank you, Lord. I win. Hallelujah. You know, we win.
Amen.
Amen. Tell your neighbor, we win. Hallelujah. In Jesus, you win. Hallelujah. You have the victory all the time. Hallelujah. Life of victory. Amen. So we're talking about God's stimulus package. Getting the title of the message. The subject is getting the most out of your Christian life. All right. So let's jump right into this word of God. Amen. We're going to start over here in Proverbs 10 and 22. And then we're going to look over in Matthew 7. And, of course, we're going to be looking at the whole chapter of Matthew 7 because it's got some good stuff in it that's going to help you and bless you. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen. All right, so Proverbs 10 and 22, it reads as such, "The blessing of the Lord, it maketh rich, and he had no sorrow with it." Amen? Now, let's turn over to Matthew 7, and we're going to start at the first verse, and we're going to read all the way down. It says, "Judge not that ye be not judged, for with what judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged, and with what measure ye meet, it shall be measured to you again. And why beholdest thou the mote in thy brother's eye, but considerest not the beam that is in thine own eye? Or how wilt thou say to thy brother, let me pull out the mote of thine eye, and behold, a beam is in thine own eye?" You know, sometimes we get lost in, you know, what this King James is saying. You know, it says, you know, the mote in your eye, the beam in the mote in their eye and the beam in your eye. What does that really mean? Well, it's kind of like having a little sliver or something, you know, in the corner of your neighbor's eye, but you got this big, huge pole, telephone pole, hanging out your head, and you sitting there talking about, "You in sin, brother. You in sin. You need to stop doing that." And your stuff is like catastrophically big, and you sitting there. I see it right there. No. And you can't even turn your head without knocking something over. That beam is so big in your head. You knocking everything over. It's like, whoa, you know. All right. Praise God. Let's continue on. It says, "How would I say to thy brother, let me pull out the mote of thine eye, and behold, a beam is in thine own eye? Thou hypocrite, first cast out the beam out of thy own eye, and then shalt thou see clearly to cast out the mote out of thy brother's eye. Give not that which is holy unto the dogs, neither cast ye your pearls before the swine, lest they trample under their feet, and turn again and rend you. Ask, and it shall be given you. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh receiveth, and everyone that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be opened. Or what man is there of you whom, if his son ask a bread, he will give him a stone? Or if he ask a fish, will he give him a serpent? If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your Father, which is in heaven, give good things to them that ask him? Therefore, all things whatsoever ye would that men do to you, do ye even so to them. For this is the law and the prophet. Enter ye at the straight gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat. Because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life. And few there be that find it. Beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. Ye shall know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles? Even so." All right, praise God. We're amped now. "Even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. Wherefore, by their fruits ye shall know them. Mm-hmm. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? In thy name have cast out devils. And in thy name done many wonderful works. And I will profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Some folks going to hit hell wide open. Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them. Say, doeth them. I will liken unto him a wise man which built his house upon a rock, and the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. And everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man. Say, foolish man. Which built his house upon a rock, which built his house upon the sand, and the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. And it came to pass when Jesus ended these sayings, the people were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught them as one having authority, not as the scribes. Amen? Amen. So there's something in this message for everybody. Everybody. This is a lot in that seventh chapter of Matthew. You should go back and rehearse this in your private time. Let the Lord minister to you along these lines. Ask the Lord where you fit in this word. Be sure to keep an open heart and mind. You'll be able to locate yourself somewhere in this message today. Now, we're talking about the stimulus package. What is a stimulus package? You know, in 2008, when President Obama, he came into office and stuff, and, you know, he said, we're going to stimulate the economy. You know, we're going to send these checks out to y'all. You know, y'all going to have some money, and y'all going to put it back into the economy. We're going to stimulate the economy. Well, that was good. You know, that was, on the surface, that seemed good, you know, but we're increasing the debt of the nation, and people didn't really spend the money like they thought they was going to spend it. And then on top of that, well, then you had to pay taxes on it. Yeah, you got hit when, you know, they say, oh, you got to report this on your taxes. Now, what? Huh? Oh, doggone. Hey, man, I wish you even gave it to me, you know? That's how people was feeling when they got this free money. Ain't nothing free. Amen. This ain't free. Yeah. But anyway, I say that because, see, God's got a stimulus package. Amen. There's no penalties. There's no hidden agenda. This is not going to cost you on the back end. Amen. This is going to bless your life. Hallelujah. It's going to make sure you have more than enough. It's going to equip you for the work that he has for you to do in the earth. Amen? Amen. Do you know you have a job to do here in the earth? Yes. And we're not talking about working down at AT&T. That's not the job we're talking about. We're not talking about the job working at Popeyes or whatever. We ain't talking about that. We're talking about the job as a child of God to be light and salt in the earth, to be a witness for the Lord Jesus. Amen? Amen. That's the job we're talking about today. That's the most important job you can ever have. Amen. Being a witness for Christ, being light and salt in the earth, showing people that there's a better way to live. Amen. That there's a Savior, that there's a hell to shun and a heaven to gain. Amen. You need to know, you need to be letting people know this on the job, down at food line, everywhere you go. You need to be letting somebody know that Jesus died for you, so that you can have life and have it more abundantly, and so that you can maneuver through this life victoriously. Amen? We are here to have victorious life. And this message today is to assist you in enhancing the victorious life that you should already be experiencing. Amen? Hallelujah. So we're looking at, as we're talking about the stimulus package, we want some good scriptures that we want to bring to your understanding here. Deuteronomy 8 and 18. Go ahead and write that down. But thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, for it is he that giveth thee the power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant which he swore unto thy fathers this day. That's Deuteronomy 8 and 18. Now, what we're talking about now is we're talking about God's stimulus package. We're talking about getting the most out of your Christian life. Amen. You know, there are going to be people in your life, and some of them are going to be your friends. And you want to make sure that you know the what category to put some of these individuals in. Because, see, sometimes, you know, unknowingly, we put everybody in the same category of friendship, and they don't all need to be in the same category. Amen? You know, you will have some friends that smile in your face and pat you on the back and make you feel like you're the best thing since sliced bread. Oh, man, oh, you're so wise, man. You're a man. I just love you, man. You're my boy. You're my dog. You know? But then they don't honor anything or any advice that you give them. In reality, you're only there to make them feel good about themselves. Because just as soon as you try to correct them or instruct them in the things of God, all of a sudden they change the subject and start making excuses. You know, I've got individuals in my life, and, you know, some of them really value me and what I have to say. And because they really value me, I in turn really value them. Amen. You know, if the Lord says something to me concerning them, I try to relay to them exactly what the Lord say without delay. Amen. And in love. Amen. Amen. I categorize friendships in three ways. This is the way the Lord gave it to me. Three ways, three categories you should look to these people, these individuals that are a part of your life. You should put them in one of these three categories. And it's important. You're going to see very, very shortly how important that's going to be. Amen. And the first one is full contact. The second one is medium contact friend. And the third is a light contact friend. Now, the Lord uses people to bless you. And this is important because you want God to be able to use as many people as possible to get provision to you, because the Lord blesses you through people. Amen. Amen. That's not the only way, but one of the ways the Lord blesses you is through your interaction with other people. Amen. And I'm not just talking money, you know, because see, sometimes somebody do a favor for you, man, it's worth thousands of dollars. Amen. Now, you know, I'm going to talk about three individuals here. All of them are named John. All right? These three individuals are going to fit into one of these three categories: the heavy contact friendship, medium contact friendship, light contact friendship. Now, the first person that I'm talking about, his name is Papa John. Amen? Yeah, we know Papa John. And no. We're going to talk about Jimmy John. We're going to talk about Jimmy John first. Jimmy John is the full contact. He's a full contact friend. He genuinely cares about what's going on with you. They are responsive to what you need, and they commit real time to pray for you. Real time. This person always is adding value to your life. These individuals are few and far between. You need to recognize who these people are, because they are the most important people that you're going to have in your life. And you need to spend time cultivating those relationships. Amen. Right. Now, the second friendship that you're going to run into is the medium contact friendship. Now, his name is Papa John. Now, Papa John, he's not quite, you know, what Jimmy John is. Not freaky fast. You know, not, but you know, he does okay. But let me tell you about Papa John. He comes around ever so often, and really only wants to talk about himself and his situation. He asks you what you think and does the opposite of what you recommend. That's Papa John. He's still your friend. You know, he's not bad to you or nothing like that, but, you know, he is what he is. You know. But let's talk about the light contact friendship. Now, this one, you don't want to spend very little time with this relationship, as little time as possible. Don't spend a lot of mental energy trying to, you know, figure out what's going on, with why things aren't better, da 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 da. Just let it be what it is, and push it off to the side somewhere. John Deere doesn't really value anything that you say. Always feel like they're trying to outdo you. They want you to do well, but just not better than them. Uh-huh, yeah. You call them and tell them about a sale that's going on right now. Man, I'm down here at the Piggly Wiggly, man, and man, they got five for a dollar. And then they sit there, this is John Deere for you. You know, they tell you about a sale that they went to 2 months ago, and it was 10 for a dollar. And they sitting there snickering at you because you missed the 10 for one sale. Like, man, I thought we was boys. Why didn't you call me and tell me that you were, you know, they had a 10 for a dollar? I would come down there and go, man, you know, man, I bought 40 of them, man. Man, I my phone died. I couldn't even call you. Yeah, I'm sure it did. Your phone ain't never died. Now it died when you trying to talk. You talking about calling me, you know? And I call you up trying to tell you about something, and you done already got the super deal and won't even share it. I thought we was boys. But this relationship is what it is. It is what it is. Don't get all frustrated and torn up about the fact that they care very little about what's going on with you. Like I said, you want to spend time cultivating the heavy contact friendship, the person that values you, the person that calls you, see how you doing. Hey, how you doing? You know, man, you know, the Lord had me on my heart, and I was just praying for you. Do you need anything? You know? Number one, you need to strive to be that type of person so you can attract those type of people in your life. And secondly, you need to identify who the medium and light contact folks is so you can just kind of push them off to the side somewhere. Not that you're going to treat them bad, but you don't want to spend a lot of time focusing on them because they don't really value you no way. Amen? Can you say amen? Praise God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So we don't want to focus on John Deere. We don't want to focus on Papa John. We want to focus on Jimmy John. Jimmy John's freaky fast. He's Johnny on the spot. Bam. You know, you ain't even run the door. You ain't even set the phone down. You're like, Jimmy John, ding ding. Hey, Jimmy John, what's going on, buddy? Man, I was just thinking about you. I got this right here for you. You know, you want to focus on Jimmy John. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. At this point, it's time to evaluate. Which one of these individuals are you? Uh-oh. Concerning your friends, where would you categorize each one of them? Your relationships with people can either add value and blessing to your life, or they can drain and diminish your life. You want to surround yourself with individuals who add value to your life. Amen. Don't allow yourself to spend a lot of time trying to cultivate and grow medium and light contact relationships. Your energy will be better served and rewarded by identifying individuals who can be high contact friends. Ask the Lord who those individuals are. And if you're married, ask the Lord to show you couples. In high contact relationships, there should exist a level of accountability. Amen. And that goes both ways. You're accountable to them, they're accountable to you. That's right. Because you genuinely care for one another, you're praying for one another, you have each other's best interest at heart. Amen? Yeah. Praise God. Now, you know, as I said earlier, I'm a full disclosure person. I try to live my life like an open book. What you see is what you get. Amen. You know, for the most part, I'm fairly quiet and reserved, you know. But there are times when I do get loud and ignorant. Yeah. You know, sometimes I'm ignorant, you know. And, you know, that's just the way I am. You just get what you get, you know. But I try to keep things interesting like that. I try to keep things interesting. I try to be the most interesting person you know. Amen. And for a lot of people, that's true. Because I keeps it interesting. Amen. Now, you know, my wife, she's different than I am. She's more like checkers. I'm more like chess. You know. We complement one another, though. She's more like a samurai, cut you straight down the middle. And I'm more like a ninja. I sit off in the corner and blow a dart at you. Whew. You know, I'm going to watch you like a cat. I'm going to watch you like a cat for a long time before I pounce on you.
Yes, sir.
Amen?
Never see me coming.
Praise God. In marriage, becoming one is a process.
It's a process.
The longer she and I are married, the more our character and nature will become similar. Amen. You know, now, John Deere, you know, we were talking about John Deere. John Deere is the light contact. John Deere, he and his wife are just alike. If I text John Deere, they don't respond. If she texts his wife, she don't respond. Don't respond. Then we see him later like, did you get my text? I was so busy, I just didn't get a chance to, but it's been 2 weeks. You know? He's sitting there like, but, it is what it is. Now that can be good or bad, just like Ananias and Sapphira. You remember that story over at Acts, the 5th chapter?
Yes, sir.
You know, Ananias, he went, the move of the Lord is taking place. People are giving into the work of the Lord. People are just selling land and selling different things, and bringing the monies and stuff to the apostles and stuff. And we want to bless the kingdom. Hey, this is I sold this land, and now I want to bless the kingdom with it. Well, see, that's all great and good if that's what you did. But see, now Ananias and Sapphira, they done plotted together to deceive not the apostles, but they want to try to put something over on the Lord. They think this is about fooling men. This ain't about men's stuff. This is God's stuff. And so they have plotted to tell this lie right there in the church. You believe what? Can you believe it? People lying in the church. They doing it right now. People lying right now in the church. But this right here started happening. They stop all that lying. They say, "Yeah, I'm bringing my tithe." Boom. I guess that wasn't all of it. You get the lying in, boy. It won't take but a couple folks dying, to stop a bunch of stuff. But you know what? The Lord loves us, and He's gracious and compassionate and merciful. Thank God for His mercy. Because, Lord, no, I would have been dead a long time ago if it wasn't for the mercy of God. Yeah. Amen. So, we're not advocating, Lord, kill some folks. No. We're not advocating that. But at the same time, you do want to have some integrity, especially in dealing with the things of God. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. And so you don't want to be like Ananias and Sapphira, lose yourself over, over a few dollars. Oh, no. Who you elect to align yourself with can either bless your life or it can cost you your life. Amen. Sometimes the Lord allows people to come into your life that He can teach you something about Himself. On the other hand, He may also be using you to teach someone else. So it's an exchange that's taking place. We need to learn to be sensitive to the leading of the Spirit on whether or not you should be learning something or whether or not He's using someone else to teach you. It may be a little bit of both. Amen?
Yes, sir.
But be a yielded vessel. Be open to whichever the way the Lord is leading you. Amen? Don't be so deep in the Spirit to think God's only going to use you to teach and instruct somebody. I know it all. I have 4 doctorates, and I bake cookies. Ain't nobody better. The Bible says pride comes before a fall. Amen? And you about to bust your head on that concrete, taking a fall. Amen? Jesus was led of the Spirit into the wilderness. Jesus had to deal with the devil in the wilderness. Jesus had to overcome the temptations of the flesh. And Jesus had to rely on His relationship with the Father to bring Him through His wilderness experience. Spiritual growth cannot happen without the wilderness experience. Amen? You're going to have to go through something to mature you and to help you understand and realize that, just because you got a doctorate does not mean you are victorious automatically. Amen? Just because your parents, your uncle is a billionaire, that does not make you victorious. Amen? Only your relationship, a consistent, dedicated relationship to the things of God is what's going to bring you over every single time. Amen? And you need to remember that. Y'all remember, as I said earlier, you want to take good notes because you will be tested on this material. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, what we just shared can be found over in Luke 4, the 1st through the 14th verse, Luke 4, chapter 1 through 14, if you want to take time and read that. I'm going to have to, you know, I'm going to have to touch some things. I'll touch some things a little more than others. But if you take notes, you can, and of course, you know, you can always go back to the website and view the message in its entirety. Amen. But you want to have some things you can write down, you know, so you can go back as the Lord directs you. Amen. Amen. We need to be able. Now we get ready to talk about Laban now. Laban is another individual you need to look out for. Now, Laban in the Bible was a very sneaky individual, if you know anything about him. Now, this person, you know, I'm calling him Laban, but his name was something else. But we're not calling anybody's real name because, you know, we're not trying to emphasize who they are. We're trying to show you these individuals collectively. Amen. We're not trying to embarrass anybody. Amen. That's not what preaching is about. That's not what ministry is about. The Bible says love covers a multitude of sin. So, you know, we're not trying to pull the cover off and expose folks, but we're just trying to show you, you know, how you can identify these types of individuals and prepare yourself accordingly. Amen. So we're talking about Laban now. You need to be able to recognize Laban, a wolf in sheep's clothing. You may find them on your job, in your family, or even at the church. At the church, oh Lord, say so. You know, some of the sneakiest, slimiest folks you can find right in the church. And that's sad to say, but it's still true. Well, how do we know that? Well, Judas was right there with Jesus. You know, getting gravy on his biscuit and everything. Oh, Lord. This is the best gravy. Can you pass the gray poupon, Lord? You know. And, man, he's just as deceitful as he can be. You know. And so we see through our example in the Word of God, you're going to run up against these folks. And you need to know what you need to be doing and how you need to conduct yourself so that you can maneuver effectively through life. Amen. We're talking about maximizing your Christian life here on earth. Amen. It's not all fluff and puff. You're going to have to deal with some stuff. There's going to be some valley experiences. You're going to have to endure some tests and some trials. Amen. Jesus said, if it wasn't so, I wouldn't have told you. Amen. So now, these individuals are opportunistic parasites. They see the blessing of God on your life and they want it. But you must go through them to get to your destination. Amen. Your love walk is going to take a hit on this one. Because they're going to maximize your ability to love like none other. Because these folks are slimy. Man, they sit there, they smile in your face. Yep. You know, they sit there and pat you on the back. Man, so much. But the Lord is so gracious and kind to let you know about the battle that's about to take place. And for some, you're already facing something that the Lord is saying to you. And the Lord is saying to you, be steadfast. Hold your ground. You got this. You got this. You can handle it. The Bible says it this way. 1 Corinthians 10:13 says, there have no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. But God, who is faithful, will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation make a way of escape that ye may be able to bear it.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
You got this. Amen. You can handle this in Jesus. Amen. 1 Corinthians 15:58. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Amen. We're going to finish talking about Laban here. Laban in the church is the most dangerous. You know, they quote scriptures. They sing on the choir. They're members of the deacon board. You know, many times you don't even see them coming. They know all the church lingo. They know how to dance and shout it. Ha! Ha! They know all that. They know when to put the amens in, you know. They know all that stuff. Judas walked with Jesus. He served with the disciples. He worshiped beside Jesus. You know, betrayal comes from those who are close to you. So you want to watch. You want to watch. Judas was not predestinated to betray the Lord. That would go against the sovereignty of God. Judas chose to betray Jesus. He chose that. over a few nickels and dimes. But the Lord is not, Second Peter 3:9 said, the Lord is not concerning, not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. That was not the plan that the Lord had for Judas. He chose that. God is not willing that any should perish. Not willing at all that any should perish. Even Judas. But he did it. He chose that path. Did nobody make him do it? It was because of the hardness of his own heart. But you know what? When you come up against Laban, you got to remind yourself, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Every tongue that shall rise against me in judgment, thou shalt condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is of me, saith the Lord. Isaiah 54:17 says. Now, 3 John 2 says, beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospers. See, what we're talking about here is God's stimulus plan. You got to know some things before you can really prosper. And you've got to have some things under your belt before God can do for you what he wants to do for you. Because your soul has to prosper. Amen? Our ability to prosper in our finances is directly related to our ability to prosper in our soul, our willpower, our emotions, our intellect. Those are the three components of the soul. I'll say it again. The willpower, the emotions, and your intellect. Amen? Your ability to reason is your intellect. Amen? And God needs to prosper you there because they are directly related to one another. Because listen to this. Proverbs 1:32 says this. This is why your soul needs to prosper. The Lord, for the turning away of the simple shall slay them, and the prosperity of fools shall destroy them. Amen? So, you know, you give a foolish person a bunch of money. You know, Creflo Dollar said it this way, money is a magnifier. You know, a person with a little bit of money can just make small endeavors. You know, and when you got a corrupt mind, you know, you have an unregenerated mind, you just, you know, you got $20, you just going to go down, you know, and get you a $20 lady. But now you got $20 million, you're going to really ramp it up. Uh-huh. Yeah. So money is a magnifier. So the Lord's already in his infinite wisdom already understands that I can't just drop a big load on you because I'm going to lose you because you're going to go plumb fool. Amen. You're going to go plumb fool. I'm going to lose you and I won't see you no more. Yeah, next time I see you, you'll be burning up talking about, Lord, I'm down here burning up. Yeah, I know. In a nutshell, amen?
Amen?
The Lord is doing some of us a favor by not allowing us to obtain great wealth. Some of us, if we come into $1 million, man, we wouldn't see y'all no more. Man, you would be, you know, you'd be down on the beach. If you like pina colada, getting caught in the rain. You gone. Till that money run out. Then you'd be on, Lord, I'm sorry, Lord, just give me another million. No. No, not going to happen like that. If you're having a hard time tithing over $500, I can already tell you what you're going to do if you get a $5 million. I can already tell you what you're going to do. And Jesus knows too.
Right.
This tithing has caused many a Christian to stumble.
That's true.
That 10 cents out of a dollar. The Lord said he has chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. 1 Corinthians 1:27 said, but God has chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and God has chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. It doesn't make any sense that I should give 10 cents out of every dollar. But that's the way the Lord set it up. So he could help you to see where you are. Oh, I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. Can I get that 10 cent now? Next week, Lord. Next week, Lord. I love you, Lord. And he's looking right at you. Yeah. Yeah. All right. But you know, the Lord is gracious and merciful and full of compassion. And he'll give you a time to grow out of that. Amen. Now, that's to your benefit that you hook up to his financial plan, because you're the one that's going to reap the benefit. But if you stay disconnected, you're going to reap the penalty as well. Amen. All right. Many of us are walking through life with a bag with holes in it. The tithe is like a financial super glue. It holds things together, both financially and materially. The tithe brings God on the scene as your financial backer. You know, if you got a wealthy, rich uncle, you know, you ain't really too much worried about that. If you're on good terms with them, they say, man, you need anything, just come holler at your boy. And I got you. That's what God is saying when you bring that tithe in. He's saying, I got you. I got you. Whatever's going on, you hooked up with me, I'm hooked up with you. I can help you work through this. Amen?
Yes.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Is anybody getting anything out of this? Man, I'm getting blessed. Amen. I'm preaching to me. The tithe brings God on the scene as your financial backer. The tithe opens the door to a total life preservation package. That's what it does. Now, I said earlier, you know, you have a, when you don't tithe, you create a bag with holes in it. Because the devil is going to certainly rip holes all in it now, because you ain't hooked up to God's plan. And so every time you think, you know, you're getting ahead, something's falling out the hole. You know, you got this big old bag, but it's just as soon as you're putting stuff in it, you're like, huh, man, I just put in triple overtime. Huh, you know, and then, you know, then the laundry, then daggone washing machine go out. Then that transmission done went out. Then it's just falling right on through. Just falling right on through. Falling right on through. You know, you're putting in all this extra effort, but it's not benefiting you none. It's going out the bottom end. But that tithe seals that stuff up. Keeps that stuff preserved. You know what preservatives do? Man, you keep some stuff in a daggone cabinet till Jesus come back. It's got so much preservatives in it. You know? But man, you know, but that's the way you need to see your finances. You need to put some preservative on that stuff. You know, I'm so thankful and blessed because I finally got it with that tithe. I'm not going to miss no time with that tithe, because God has always proven himself over and over and over and over and over again because I am a tither, because I bring that 10 cents out of the dollar. Man, there have been times where, you know, things have happened at the house. You know, just recently, we bought a Samsung dryer. You know, sorry, Samsung, but you know, whatever. I ain't real happy with you, Samsung. Not right now. I spent money, bought this dryer, brand new dryer, you know, and dryer stopped heating. I'm sitting there like, doggone, we just bought this dryer.
Brand new.
And of course, it always go out after the warranty. Go out after the warranty, and the warranty ain't no time to begin with. You know, you used to buy these appliances, man, you ain't think about having to do nothing to them for at least 10 years.
At least 10.
Now, 10 months. You're going to have to start doing something to it. But guess, you know, it is what it is, okay? But, you know, we serve a good God. He always makes a way out of no way. But anyway, dryer went out. My wife's like, well, what are we going to do? You know, we need to call somebody. At first, I called somebody, you know, because I'm not an appliance technician or anything by that stretch of the imagination. And then, you know, the gentleman that I called, you know, he was just taking his time, you know, won't return my call, you know. I got to go to the daggone laundromat and stuff to dry my clothes and stuff. I'm like, man, this is getting old. Man, we need to do something about this dryer. You know, but because I'm connected to God, because of that tithe, the Lord said, you can fix that. He said, I can. Okay. And so I'm down there. Got my little drill out. I'm taking it apart. You know. And I mean, you know, these things nowadays, you know, you just can't just jump on top of them like that.
Right.
Well, you know what? You know, the Lord is so wise. He's made so many things available to us. They got this thing called YouTube now.
There you go.
Man, you can learn how to do anything. You can build a rocket ship watching YouTube. Get to the moon, be up there. Man, this is great. Man, that YouTube is something. I'm going to have to watch it and see how to get back. You know? But anything you want to learn, you can find on that YouTube, boy. And so I'm sitting there like, oh, I'm watching the YouTube. Okay, okay. And they got the exact model and everything. Okay, you want to do this. Okay, all right, mm-hmm, okay. Bam. All right. My wife comes downstairs, whole floor full of parts. Bae, you know what you're doing? I said, I will when I'm finished. And that thing was put back together. Found it, the element was gone in it. Well, went down to the hardware store, you know, to the parts store, got a new element, put it in there, boom, it's back in business. But you know what? That could have been an expensive endeavor. And I attribute the ability to be able to handle that because the wisdom of God showed up. I'm not going to give it just to YouTube. Because YouTube had been around for a long time. And there's people right now paying somebody. But they could have done it if the wisdom of God had showed up. They could have done it. Because I tell people all the time, well, it's not that hard. And they say, oh, I'm just going to pay somebody. I'm like, okay. All right. That's what you want to do? By all means, go ahead and do it. But you know what? When the wisdom of God show up, man, I don't discount that. I don't push it off. I say, okay. You know, if you got confidence in me, Lord, I believe I can do it. You know? But see, that's that connection that you have. You know, another situation that I'm going to have got to move along. But guess what? You know, my riding mower, you know, went out. The steering went out on my riding mower. You know, so I'm turning this way and the wheel's still straight. And I'm like trying to, man, the daggone steering linkage done messed up in it. And, of course, you know, another potentially expensive endeavor, you know. And I'm sitting there like, well, Lord, you know, do I need to call somebody? You know, I'm genuinely waiting on God to tell me what to do. Because I just don't want to assume that I can just jump on something. Because, see, sometimes you tear it up more than you will fix it. You know, then you got to buy a new one. And so, you know, when you start getting these high dollar items go out, you don't want to just jump on it right away. You know, you just call somebody, well, I'm going to go ahead and let you handle that, you know. I don't try to fix everything, you know. A gentleman told me one time, and I use this in my own life, he said, a man ought to know his limitations.
That's right.
You know. Now, of course, with the Lord's help, your limitations get expanded, amen, because God come in and supernaturally help you, and that has happened so many times. I'm so thankful. I am so thankful to the Lord. Because there have been many times where if the Lord hadn't shown me how to do it, man, I'd have been stuck. But, you know, that tithe helps you with that. You know, here's another example. would you rather, if you were going to have a car, if your car was going to break down, it was unavoidable, your car was going to break down on you, which of these two scenarios would you rather have when your car broke down? Number one, car breaks down on I-10, going down the highway, family on vacation, full of luggage, y'all trying to go have a good time. Would you rather your car break down then? It's 90 degrees outside, you know, and you got traffic backed up, and you trying to figure out what is wrong with this piece of junk? You're like, man, this is terrible. My whole vacation is interrupted. I don't even know how much this is going to cost, and I just got enough money just to take the vacation. I ain't got no money for a repair bill, too. Would you want to have that scenario? Or would you be like, come out one morning, click, 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 click. It done broke down in the driveway. Well, I would rather have scenario number two. All day. But, you know, people run into these scenarios all the time. But because the Lord is gracious and merciful and he's watching you and got your back, you're going to have, it's going to go out. It's going to go out. Whatever happened is going to happen. But God is so gracious and merciful that he allowed this to happen when all you got to do is just go on back in the house, I call the tow truck. You know, I get it fixed when I get it fixed. I drive the other car.
There you go.
You know, no loss, no harm. No, you don't even miss a beat. Amen. That's a far better scenario than 90 degrees and it's 90% humidity and everybody's sweating and crying because we out here in the middle of the highway, you know, waiting for 2 hours for a tow truck to show up, and now we don't know when we're going to get home or if we're even going to be able to take the vacation. Man, man, there's people in that scenario right now because they're not hooked up. But none of you, because you hooked up, because you believe God, because you will bring that 10 cents out of a dollar. It's worth so much more than that dime you give it. It's worth so much more. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Anybody getting anything out of that? Amen. Hallelujah. The tither has access to supernatural healing, divine favor, the wisdom of God. When the Lord said he would open up the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing in Malachi 3, he wasn't just talking about money. Money is part of it, but not all of that blessing that the Lord is talking about is money. Like I said, you know, when stuff go wrong, it ain't got to go horribly wrong. Amen? See, you could have a situation that was bad, but it wasn't horribly wrong. You know, you're in a whole nother category when it goes horribly wrong. Amen? All right, so continuing on. Now, remember what we said. You know, the Lord knows, you know, you got to be faithful over that, which you got to be faithful over that 10 cents out of a dollar. He that is faithful in that which is least is also faithful in that which is much. And he that is just in the least is also unjust in that which is much. Luke 16 and 10.
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fbc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.